Welcome to Learning Unit 2 of End User Computing A. I'm Julian, and we are talking about exploring the Windows 7 operating system. The objectives for today are the keyboard and special keys, the mouse and mouse actions you can perform, the desktop and parts of the desktop, Windows and base concepts relating to Windows, Windows error features, help and support that you can get from the computer, and how to turn your computer off. The keyboard is your main input. It's the way you get things into the computer. So, for example, you may type sentences in a word processing program or figures into a spreadsheet. There are two main layouts that we will see throughout our lives as we use the computer. The most common one in use in South Africa is QWERTY, which is QWERTY, all in the upper left-hand corner of the keyboard, and the Dvorak layout, which is a little weird and a lot of most of Europe will use. The keyboard is broken up into pieces. The special keys that you can use on these pieces are, for example, the function keys, F1 through to F12. A common example is that F1 will get you your universal help. Control and Alt don't normally do anything by themselves, but for example, if you press Control, Alt, and Delete together, you will get a menu which prompts you to, one of the prompts is to let you change your password. Shift on the keyboard allows you to type one capital letter, so Shift A will produce a capital letter A. Caps Lock on the computer will turn a light on the computer keyboard, and once it's on, it'll allow you to type all capital letters. Enter is normally confirming an action, so normally when there's a dialogue on the screen, if you press Enter, you will say, yes, I wish to do whatever it is that's on the dialogue. Space allows you to press spaces between words in a sentence. Backspace will take away letters in a sentence. So, for example, if you typed something correctly, you could backspace, remove the error, and type the new sentence or fragment that you wish to type. You'll notice on the bottom of the drawing there's a bunch of numbers. When you press number lock on the keyboard, which is in the upper right hand corner, it behaves like caps lock. It turns a light on the computer. As long as it's on, you can type numbers for figures, and as long as it's off, you can use the number keys to move around on the screen. The mouse itself has got what we call mouse actions. The mouse is your extension of your hand inside the computer, and it moves what is known as the pointer, which is a little arrow that lets you aim and hit specific things like icons and menus and so forth. There are three actions that we care about. Clicking, which is just a single action, you hit the left mouse button once, and when you click, you are thinking of doing something, and it looks a bit like that. You click once. When you double click, you are actually doing something. So you might open a program or open a file or go into a menu. Not so much that, but you will use the double click to do something. This looks like that. The right mouse button is your context sensitive menu. Context sensitive means where you are defines what happens. If you right click on the desktop, you'll get a very different menu from if you right click on an icon. This looks like that. Right click is only clicking once, by the by. The desktop is made up of different components. The big main component is the desktop itself. On the desktop, everything else happens and lives. For example, we have icons. An icon is a representative of a program or a file. Under the desktop, we have the taskbar, which is where all the jobs that you do ever go. On the left-hand side of the taskbar, we have the start menu. And on the right-hand side, we have the notification area. The start menu is where we access our programs and our documents. And the notification area is where we see where problems with the computer are, or the time, and so on and so forth. The idea of Windows is that they are broken up into little different pieces as well. You have your title bar, which runs along the top and tells you the name of a window. You have the main menu for the program, which shows you what you can and can't do with the program. You have the main window, which is where you'll do most of your work. And your status bar, which shows you how you're driving. If you're in a word processing software, it'll show you how many words or how many letters and so forth. The two main actions that you can do with the window are you can move the window around by grabbing the title bar, and you can resize the window by grabbing its edges and dragging and making the windows bigger or smaller. In the upper right-hand corner of any window, you will see three little buttons. And these three buttons are the Minimize, Maximize, Restore, and Close buttons. The Minimize will take a window and send it to the taskbar. The Maximize and Restore button will do the following, which is expand the window so that it is full screen, or restore the window back to its original size if it was small to begin with. Closing will stop the program from running altogether. Arrow's new in Windows 7, and Arrow tries to make it easier for you to use your desktop. When you use Arrow, there are three common ideas that go into making your desktop easier to use. The first of which is Shake, the second of which is Snap, and the third of which is Arrow Flip 3D. When you shake a window, you end up with only that window on the screen, and all of the other windows get minimized. When you snap, you fill the left or the right-hand side of the window, the desktop, with the program, and if you go to the top, you will end up with a maximized window. Arrow Flip 3D allows you to, if you have many programs and they're all running at the same time, change to whichever program you need to use right now. If you're drawing a drawing for a report, you might go from your word processor to your paint program. Help and support is how you make sense of Windows and Windows problems. If you're having an issue at any point in time, you can press F1. It will bring up the help system and you can work through it to get to where you need to be to solve your particular problem. When you want to turn off your computer, normally the first thing you'll do in a multi-user environment is you'll log off. But if you're on a single-use computer, there are three concepts you need to be aware of. You can shut down the computer, which turns the computer off completely. You can restart the computer, which basically lets you start the computer from scratch. Or you can hibernate the computer, which is where all the programs that you're working with go to memory, and they stay in memory as long as the computer is in a shutdown but still sort of half on state. When you bring the programs and computer back to wakefulness, then all those programs and documents and so forth that you were looking at come back to the fore so that you can use them. And that is all for this lesson. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Julian. and I shall see you in the next learning unit.